South Africa has been in the news a lot lately, but not in a good way. There's the pending extinction of the white rhinoceros and South Africa as the rape capital of the world, fistfights in parliament, rampant AIDS, and sometimes, not nearly often enough, there is reporting of black-on-white crime so intense as to be a sort of slow-motion genocide. Almost never mentioned is the fact that this crime wave is actively encouraged by racist, anti-white elements in parts of the South African government. Now, if you're thinking that those evil white people are just getting what they deserve, here's a little history. The Afrikaners established the Cape Colony in 1652. The only inhabitants of the area were a few nomadic bands roving the countryside. The black tribes, now saying the land belongs to them, weren't there. Whites first encountered them up around the Fish River, some 1,200 miles from the Cape Colony, about 120 years after the colony was founded. With that out of the way, let's move on. I've traveled Africa from top to bottom, I've hitchhiked across the Sahara, and I know Southern Africa pretty well. All my travel was up close and personal, occasionally riding in comfortable buses, but more often hitching rides in cars, in the backs of trucks packed with locals, or whatever was available. And that did a lot of just plain walking, alone and unmolested. Most of the black Africans I met, especially those in the bush, were helpful, friendly, curious people among whom I never felt threatened, despite my constant awareness that I was in some pretty dicey areas, including the Angolan border. Unfortunately, as we shall see, the whole dynamic can change in certain places at certain times. In 1993, the year before Mandela was elected president, I spent several months in South Africa. I had two main reasons for being there. One was to get into Angola to interview Jonas Savimbi, a key player in that country's civil war, and maybe lend a hand if that seemed appropriate. That didn't work out. But my second reason for being in South Africa was very successful. I was able to witness the political drama leading up to the fatal election of 1994. Many white South Africans, with the fall of Rhodesia fresh in their minds, were predicting war if the African National Congress came to power. In this tense atmosphere, I managed to meet many of the main white leaders and help out their cause where I could. Even then, in 1993, the sense of threat against whites was so thick you could cut it with a panga. For example, while I was there, a white man got drunk and wandered into a black township outside of Johannesburg, where the locals cut off his testicles and used them to make muti, our traditional African medicine. The crime rate against whites was high. All the white-owned houses I visited, in both rural and urban areas, had iron bars on the doors and windows, and razor wire topping the fences around them. Much of the threat was from ordinary criminals, but not all of it. In areas bordering the autonomous tribal lands, farmers were murdered and their houses burned by terrorists of the Azanian People's Liberation Army. These black guerrilla bands came across the border in the dark of night, hit their targets, and scurried back across the border. I visited a man in one of these border areas, a charismatic, good-humored farmer named Eddie, who trained local youth in military skills to protect against such raids. We spent a day in the bush as he instructed them in shooting, moving, and communicating across the terrain. Eddie and a few of us piled into Land Rovers and drove her to what was left of a homestead just over the hill that had recently been burned out. We all carried automatic rifles for protection, including his blonde teenage daughter. Why the caution? The motto of the Azanian People's Liberation Army, or APLA, was one settler, one bullet. And their commander, Sabelo Fama, had declared that he would aim his guns at children to hurt whites where it hurt the most. Now, you may think all of this is old news, but it isn't. It's ongoing news. My point is that organized groups of South African blacks killing white civilians goes all the way back to the 1990s and earlier. What we are witnessing today is not a new thing, but only a variation on an old thing.
I was shot two times here. And once here in the neck, and it went outside my head.
In South Africa, The past is the present. Incredibly, these APLA fighters were integrated into the new South African Army after Mandela came to power, as were the guerrilla forces of the African National Congress, well known for their skills as torturers. Maybe that helps explain governmental involvement in anti-white terrorist attacks today. Returning to the current situation, there's strong evidence that some of the police are actively aiding home invaders. A member of the South African Police Service told investigative reporter Katie Hopkins, under conditions of anonymity, that, quote, "We have arrested serving members of the police during house robberies. Police weapons have been used in the attacks, not just personal weapons issued to every officer, but rifles that had to be signed out from the station. We know police ammunition has been used in farm attacks." Unquote. If you think this is a fantasy, consider this photograph, caught by a CCTV camera during one farm raid. The contraption on the farm invader's back is a Chinese-built device that goes by the nomenclature of a JAM-501. It was originally designed to keep terrorists from using cell phones for detonating improvised explosive devices. In this case, it is being used to keep besieged white farmers from calling for help. Now, if you think some random criminal is going to get his hands on one of these, think again. They're expensive military hardware and not easy to get a hold of. These criminals have government support. So, what is the end game for these atrocities? The plan is ultimately to purge South Africa of whites. This is consistent with what's happening inside the South African Parliament, which recently voted to confiscate white-owned land without compensation, and where Julius Malema, right-hand man of the current president, remarked a few weeks ago that, quote, "We're not calling for the slaughter of whites yet," unquote.
We are not calling for the slaughtering of white people, at least for now.
The bottom line is, whites are being genocided in South Africa, and all the denials from the left are simply because they cannot bring themselves to admit that noble blacks anywhere in the world are victimizing white people. Or maybe they just don't think that white men, women, and children are worth saving. Okay, enough about the problem. What I've said so far is not meant to depress you, it's meant to motivate you. What can you, as an individual living thousands of miles away from the literal scene of the crime, do to help white South Africans? There are a number of organizations making a difference. Here are three for which I can personally vouch. You can find them on Facebook and on their respective websites. Saidlanders is a group that believes civil war will come soon, and they may well be right. Saidlanders is a civil defense organization, not a paramilitary outfit, designed to peacefully evacuate white South Africans to protected areas where they can survive a crisis with relative safety. It is compliant with international laws governing civil defense organizations. I met two of their representatives, and they are rock solid. Another group, called simply South Africa Project, is an informational outlet informing people about the situation in South Africa. You're not likely to find this kind of coverage anywhere else. Their site will provide ample fuel for your propaganda efforts. The founder of this group is a South African who helped me immensely on my trip to that country, and I recommend her without reservation. She also heads the Living Waters Foundation, which focuses on action rather than information. Their first priority is providing food, clothing, and lodging for orphaned white children, and secondly, to help protect and support white farmers. Spread the word about the plight of white South Africans. The more people we inform, the more support there will be on all fronts, and the harder it will be for the anti-white forces in that country to get away with their evil deeds. Don't say you can't do anything about this, because you can. We're all Boers now. Thank you for watching this episode of Wolf Age. Contact me at wolfagemedia@gmail.com to inquire about signed copies of my book, Alsatru, A Native European Spirituality, or to purchase one of our Vote on Mittwochs t-shirts.